Thank you so much for coming. I know many of you are here at your professor's request, but I hope that you have a great time. My name is Dr. McGuire, as Dr. Hill said, and I teach ACS, but I also have a degree in music. I'm really passionate about listening to music and about being a good connoisseur of what we listen to. So the goal of today's program, we did this last year for the first time, and it was a pretty good success. So we thought, let's do this again, with the goal being that instead of just hearing live music, which I think is always exciting, if you've ever been to a concert, it's more fun to have music played live. But along with that, sometimes you want to know more, and then you don't really have an opportunity to find out that more. So my part in this is to give you all a little background on what the composer, who the composer was, and what he was doing. And then we'll have the pleasure of listening to the song cycle, Hermit Songs. So the composer, his name is Samuel Barber, born in 1910, very near here in Westchester, Pennsylvania. So maybe like 25 minutes from campus. He was born to an Irish family, and he knew he wanted to be a musician and a composer from the time he was 9 years old. Now, I'm a faculty advisor, and I myself was undeclared when I came. I'm a Villanova alum, too. I was undeclared coming in here, so I can't imagine knowing what I wanted to be when I was nine. But here's a person who knew and wrote a letter to his mother saying, and there were some misspellings. He was in fourth grade, so let's cut him slack. But he said, "Mom, please do not make me play sports. I want to be a musician. Love, Sammy." That is a true story. Not a direct quote exactly, but the story itself in its essence. Good. So it's a very sweet story. And he was very gifted. At the age of 14, he became the second student to enroll in what was then the brand new Curtis Institute of Music, which is really Philadelphia and even nationally a flagship conservatory, where it is full tuition scholarship to get there. It's extremely selective, and they pay everything. Our pianist was telling me they even give the piano majors a piano. If you know how much a piano costs, that's an enormous scholarship. So he was the second student to be at Curtis Institute, and there, the other students revered him. This is at age 14. Can you imagine being revered at age 14? As the fourth B, Bach, Beethoven, Brahms, and Barber. It's pretty epic, right? He graduated from Curtis with a bachelor's degree in music in 1933, and then went on to travel in Europe while he was honing his compositional skills under some new mentors. As he began to publish his compositions and have them performed, he was an immediate success. This is really unusual. Anyone in the arts usually has to really grind it out for a while, just trying to play small venues to make it work until you're discovered, right? Not so with Samuel Barber. People recognized his talent, loved his music right away, and he became a full-time working composer, really one of the few American full-time composers in the 20th century. And by full-time, I mean he didn't have to teach, right, to make money on the side. He didn't have to wait tables. He didn't have to give guest lectures, only if he wanted to. He literally could make his entire income composing. So that just gives you a sense of really what a brilliant mind he was and a creative genius. He was really particular, a perfectionist. He agonized over everything he composed. And in virtually every genre, the symphony, the concerto, the string quartet, the opera, he composed only one piece because he just spent forever looking at each measure of music and thinking about what exactly he wanted out of it, revising and revising. The one exception to this rule, where he didn't feel that kind of pressure, was with a genre of art songs. And what we're going to be listening to today falls under that category, art songs. And the idea behind art songs is that it's a piece of classical music that sets a poem to music. And he composed over 106 songs in his lifetime. He could usually rattle one of those off in a day or two, much like your papers, I'm sure, right? You just whip those out. So he's composing these art songs, and these are enormously popular. Singers, conductors are clamoring to be able to premiere these songs, to be able to sing them in their concert halls and in their recitals. And for texts, Samuel Barber really enjoyed choosing Irish writers. So he set the text of James Joyce, William Butler Yeats. So it's not surprising that when he went to Ireland, to Donegal, in 1952, that he was really inspired by his trip and came home and began to look up some compilations of translated early Irish poetry from the early medieval period. Barber wrote to his uncle, who was also a composer, in November of 1952, quote, "These extraordinary men, monks or hermits, and they wrote these little poems on the corners of the manuscripts they were illuminating or just copying. I find them very direct, unspoiled, and often curiously contemporaneous in feeling. It's like they're speaking to me today." Barber proceeded to find English translations of these texts from different manuscripts, as I mentioned, such as Philip Allen's The Romanesque Lyric, Kenneth Jackson's A Celtic Miscellany, and Sean O'Fuelan's The Silver Branch. He also commissioned new translations of three of the poems by his friends W.H. Auden and Chester Colman. Now you may be wondering, where exactly are these marginal poems coming from? Many medieval Irish monasteries were governed by the rule of Saint Augustine. If you're wondering what that is, and you are in an ACS section, you were given a Tole Lege book last fall, and you can read the rule of Saint Augustine for yourself. I know, you're blown away, right? I can't believe this. I'm sure it's on your shelf now. You can go back and do that when we're done. So, Rule of St. Augustine, which combined work and study with a rich life of daily prayer. The men in these monasteries would receive a thorough education in Irish, the Irish language, Latin, some Greek, and much of what they learned was taught to them in verse, in rhyme. This is a very common way of educating people. If you can remember from your childhood, a lot of the things that you learned were in song and in rhyme. Those are easy things to remember. As towns grew up around the monasteries, the people surrounding the churches and the hermitages absorbed the culture and the literacy that was prevalent in monastic life. So, perhaps surprisingly, poetry and literature were revered by the Irish people, not just the monks, in the early Middle Ages. And the poems that they wrote covered a number of topics, not just religious topics. They wrote of nature, love, virtue. They told epic stories. The texts that Barber chose are personal poetry. They focus principally on the individual and his own unique relationship with God. They're not extended narratives. A lot of them are snippets. They're poems in the truest sense of evoking an image, an impression, so that you walk away with a sense that you know just what they're talking about. In order to make these settings more musical, Barber adapted some of the original texts, moving verses around, changing or removing some words, even putting together multiple translations in order to achieve his desired effect. So, if you'll pull out your program, if you have it sitting beside you, we actually have the text printed out for you today, and I think you'll find this really helpful. And I'd like to walk you through each piece and give you a little bit of a sense of what each of these 10 songs is about and some of the musical components that you might want to listen for as Betsy and Barbara perform for you. So, the first piece is At St. Patrick's Purgatory. And this has traditionally been attributed to a famous 13th century Irish religious poet, Donclove Mór O'Dalla. The title comes from the story of St. Patrick going to the island of Loch Derg, which you'll hear mentioned in the song, and he stays in a cave where he experiences temptations. And this island of Loch Derg is still a place of pilgrimage today. The original poem had 8 stanzas, but you'll see that Barber chose to set only the 1st, 2nd, and 8th in their entirety. St. Patrick is mentioned in the 3rd stanza, which was omitted, so you won't see that in your text, but that's why it's called St. Patrick's Purgatory. The omitted text from this verse is, quote, "Without sorrow or softening in my heart, bewailing my faults without repenting of them, Patrick, the high priest, never thought that he would reach God in this way." The text that Barber did choose to set reflects on the need for mortification in order to detach oneself from worldly pleasures. The pilgrim monk undertaking a journey to Loch Derg is represented musically by what's known as an ostinato. It's kind of a rhythmic refrain, a repeated pattern that you'll hear in the piano accompaniment. And the piano sort of is mimicking the steady rolling steps of the traveler. Second poem, the text of Church Bell at Night, is a very short verse that some people think might have been used to demonstrate rules of poetic meter to novices. Middle Irish poetic meter was based on syllable count with both internal and end rhymes. At a mere 4 lines, this text was preserved in its original form by Barber with 1 modification at the end. The original ending reads, "A woman foolish and light." Syntactically, that's not how we would phrase it, so he changed it, rephrased it to say, "a light and foolish woman." So that's what you'll hear. In this piece, musically, a feature is the arpeggiated chords in the piano that are sustained to sound like a bell ringing, like the church bells ringing. The third song, perhaps my favorite, St. Ida's Vision. St. Ida was known for her severe, highly physical forms of asceticism, as well as her devotion to the Holy Trinity. A number of pretty wild miracles have been attributed to her as well, including one where she reunited the head to the body of a beheaded person. She came from Kel-Ita, which today is in Kalidi in Limerick, and both Kel-Ita and Kalidi derive from the same words for Ita's church. One popular story about her says that she prayed for the gift of nursing the infant Jesus, which might sound strange, but this is actually a fairly common prayer of early medieval Irish nuns. And she was granted her request in a vision. So this song reflects on Saint Ita asking for this gift, the spiritual gift of being able to hold the infant Jesus at her breast, and then it sort of sings a lullaby to the baby when this vision is granted. This comes from one of the earliest poems out of all the ones that he chose to set, from a 9th century source, but probably written even a few centuries earlier. Barber's setting begins with what's called a recitative. It's an operatic term. If you know anything about operas, there are larger arias that are very melodic, and then in between, there's chanted dialogue. And so this begins with Saint Ita making her request of God, and this is chanted. And then a melodic, an absolutely beautiful melodic portion begins with these lilting triplets underlying the refrain, and it really gives a sense of there being a lullaby of Saint Ita rocking the baby Jesus as she nurses him to sleep. Next, the text of the Heavenly Banquet is attributed to Saint Bridget, a 5th century nun known for her generosity, her charity, and she's kind of the co-patroness of Ireland alongside Saint Patrick. One miracle attributed to her is the turning of water into beer for a leper colony. Perking up, I see. While another involved a keg that flowed with beer enough for several towns over the course of a whole weekend. At this time in history, we have to remember beer was actually probably safer to drink than water because the process involved boiling. And they also thought of it as having nutritive value because of its grains and hops. Remember that? You'll see in about the 3rd line, I think, there's 3 Marys who are mentioned. Those are traditionally Mary, the Mother of God, Mary of Bethany, so some of you may know her as the sister of Martha and Lazarus, and then the 3rd Mary, Mary Magdalene. In the piano accompaniment, you're going to hear these sort of rollicking, running eighth notes throughout that creates a scherzo-like feel. The scherzo is a form of music. It actually means joke in Italian. It's meant to be playful, humorous. It's often rather fast. And then the music in the very last line of text slows down. It kind of stretches out in a way that makes, at least I think, I don't know if Betsy will sing it this way, but when I hear it, when I'm looking at it, it makes you think that the singer is almost tipsy for a moment. It's just sort of like, ooh. And then all of a sudden the speed picks back up again and it finishes out at its original speed. Do you do that? No. So the whole piece reminds me, I don't know if you've ever seen this version, have you seen the classic Simpsons episode where Bart and Homer are in Catholic heaven? Raise your hand if you've seen Catholic and Protestant heaven. Is that not a reference point anymore? You're my husband, so you don't count. Okay. All right, so another homework assignment for you is to go Google Simpsons Catholic Heaven, and there's this great party scene. It's flowing with beer and wine, and the Irish and the Mexicans and the Italians are dancing and eating and having brawls throughout all of eternity, and it's pretty fabulous. So when I think of St. Ida asking for this river of beer to share with her savior, that's the image that comes to mind for me. All right. So next in the cycle is the Crucifixion. It was actually the first piece that Barber composed. The text is from a 14th century collection of monastic writings in Middle Irish and Latin called the Liefer Brach, or the Speckled Book. It focuses on the grief felt by Mary, Jesus' mother, as she met him carrying the cross and then stood at the foot of the cross as he was dying. This theme was a common one in medieval Christianity, and the lines would have been written right around the time when several spiritual practices were also being developed, such as the Stations of the Cross, the accompanying hymn, the Stabat Mater, or At the Cross for Station Keeping, and the Seven Sorrows of Mary. These became widespread devotions around the 13th century. This piece is achingly slow, very simple melody. The accompaniment has a kind of bird chirping motif that you'll hear with a kind of grace note that's introduced right off the bat. The piece is intense, and the tension from the dissonance kind of pulsates throughout, almost like a throbbing wound. As you'll see, and this is what makes a song cycle kind of exciting, it's like listening to a whole album all at once without stopping or without putting it on shuffle. Right? Just listening to it as the composer wanted you to hear it. And so the central pieces in the Hermit Songs really shift dramatically in mood and tone. So we've moved through a playful romp, then into almost a dirge, and now we come to this wild storm on the coast in the song Sea Snatch. So water can be a really paradoxical image, particularly in theology. It offers a key source of life. We all need water to sustain ourselves, but at the same time, it can annihilate us with drowning. The text of Sea Snatch highlights the latter theme as the poet cries out to God in the face of the destruction caused by the Irish seas. So to create these lyrics musically, Barber worked with, Barber worked with two translations of the poem, merging verses and fragments together to achieve just the right metrical symmetry. From the outset of the piece, the accompaniment is chaotic. The voice line sounds almost desperate. Accents fall on chords off the beat. The vocal line and the accompaniment race up and down the scale with pounding octaves in the bass line. It's a very physical piece to perform. And it sort of images the thrashing of the waves against the coast. If you've ever been to the shore, which I'd be surprised if anyone here hadn't, but if you've ever, especially this happens, I think, when you're younger, the waves kind of overtake you and you find yourself being smashed to the sand. Do you know that feeling? This is the kind of fear and physicality that this piece evokes. There's a lack of meter. So you may know that a lot of pieces are written in 4, or in 3, or in 6. This piece has no meter, and it leaves the listener feeling kind of unmoored. There's nothing to cling to with this, melodically or rhythmically. And then the song ends, kind of just as abruptly as it began. All right, next piece, Promiscuity. So, another shift in tone. This is maybe the most surprising and the funniest of all the verses that Barber set. It's dated as a 9th century epigram from a Celtic miscellany, and Barber again uses a literal translation of the original text, so it reads as prose, not something that rhymes. The magnetically attractive Aidan's name derives from the Irish word for fire or flame. And musically, the setting has a sort of sly, rolling feel, kind of chromatic, with dissonant intervals moving apart from each other and then back together again. So we get the sense that we aren't supposed to know Eden's secret, but we take a secret delight in our knowledge. We know where Eden's been. All right, having heard the most scandalous piece, the cycle moves next to this very sweet and cozy image of a monk and his cat. This text is quite famous, actually. It dates to the 8th century, and it can be found in the Codex St. Pauli, which, among other things, includes a commentary on Virgil, as well as astronomical observations. So this particular codex really demonstrates the breadth of knowledge of the Irish monks at this time. The poem's original name was Pangar Ban, or White Pangar, and it's one of the more famous texts, as I said, that Barber chose to set. Cats were common pets in monastic hermitages. The famous Book of Kells even features cats in its illustrations, its illuminations. Despite the poem having already been translated at least twice, Barber still asked his friend W.H. Auden to retranslate the original to make it better suited as a song lyric. So Auden shortened and substantially rearranged the text. In the original, the monk merely speaks about his cat, but in this song lyric, we witness the monk speaking to his cat directly, kind of musing on the nature of their relationship. The smooth, repeated rhythms in the piece call to mind the daily routines that the monk and the cat happily share, alone together, as the poem says. This piece actually has a hummable melody that's repeated as a refrain. And in addition to the triplets in the bass line of the piano accompaniment, the treble in the piano takes up a pattern in duple meter, in two, very chromatic, that to me, and it may be, again, it's just me, but it sounds kind of like a cat walking up and down the piano. I don't know if you have cats and a piano, but if you can picture this, you gotta listen for this when you're listening to it. It's chromatic, it's dissonant, but in kind of a cute way, you're like, aw, that's our cat, Pangar, right? The very end, the sort of the final surprise, is that it actually has a real cadence and concludes in a major key. So how about that, Samuel Barber? All right, a second poem retranslated by W.H. Auden is The Praises of God, originally dating back to the 11th century. This version is much closer to the original than The Monk and His Cat. In the second half of this very short piece, there's a kind of call and response between the voice. So the voice will be singing all day, and then you'll hear the piano have this little 16th note run, do-do-do-do, everywhere, do-do-do-do. So you want to listen for that call and response between the voice and the piano two times, and the piano responding with this joyful run. Then the vocal line ends with its own run. It's called a melisma. It's a long series of notes sung on a single syllable of the word laudation, praises. The title of the whole song cycle, Hermit Songs, may refer, probably does refer, to the 10th and final song of the series, The Desire for Hermitage. Samuel Barber seems to have truly admired the life of the hermit. His family's home was called the Hermit. Many of the earliest Irish monasteries, actually, we think of a monastery as a place where monks live in their little cells as part of a whole unit, like a Benedictine monastery. But Irish monasteries had a central church with these little huts, like kind of mud huts almost, that were surrounding the main church. So after your liturgies, you would go back to your hut, to your solitude, and that's where you do your work and your solitary prayer. So for Irish monks, even though they were living together, they were also living alone in a really significant way. Barber set only 3 of the original 15 stanzas to music in this piece. As a whole, the poem speaks of the monk's joy and satisfaction in asceticism, eating dry bread, drinking from the spring, being alone to pray. Barber interprets the monk's desire for hermitage as a kind of blissful daydream that briefly overcomes him. In this piece, and really in this piece alone, the piano has almost a cadenza of sorts. It's a long solo portion near the middle of the piece that conveys this deep longing to be free from sin and to be one with God. It's almost overwhelming. Again, with no time signature given, the musical setting has a speech-like quality to it, with just sort of random groups of twos and threes, almost like chant, that rhythmically follow the natural cadences of the words. So, Barber is, just to recap, a significant part of Philadelphia music history, as well as our Irish-American connections here at Villanova. I think the 10 songs in this song cycle speak for themselves and are a testament to the brilliance of Barber as a modern composer of classical art songs. Just so you know, these pieces are all extremely difficult to learn and to perform, but I now have the pleasure of introducing to you two extremely talented musicians, soprano Betsy Springuel and pianist Barbara Browne, who make this look easy. You've heard me use the term song cycle during my talk. A song cycle is a series of short pieces that are meant to be listened to together as a whole, as a body. So because of this, we ask that you hold your applause until all 10 songs have been sung. I really hope you enjoy Samuel Barber's Hermit Songs, and now I give you Betsy Springuel and Barbara Browne. Thank you.
She said, like to have the men of heaven in my own house, with vats of good cheer laid out for them. I would like to have the three Marys, their fame is so great. I would like people from every corner of heaven. I would like them to be cheerful in their drinking. I would like to have Jesus sitting here among them. I would like a great lake of beer for the King of Kings. It has crushed us, it has drowned us. Oh, King of the star bright kingdom of heaven. The wind has consumed us, swallowed us, as timber is devoured by crimson fire from heaven. It has broken us, it has crushed us, it has drowned us. Oh, King of the star bright kingdom of heaven. I do know that.
first off, thank you all very much for joining us this afternoon. I'm sure with this lovely weather, there were other things you could think of to do with your time. But we wanted to make sure that you guys had any opportunity to ask questions if you had any questions about either the origins of the music or the music itself. So this is your time. Don't all jump at once. Thank you very much. All right, well, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon, and go enjoy the beautiful weather.